On November the 14th, 1940, Coventry, a manufacturing centre for armaments, munitions and military vehicles, was devastated. There was heavy loss of life. Ministry of Information loudspeaker vans toured the streets.
I want to remind you about how very important it is that all water shall be boiled before being used in Coventry. No matter where you get that water from, whether it's out of a tap or anywhere else, will you please see that it is boiled before it is used. Now secondly, another announcement from the Ministry of Health. Will you please make quite certain that you don't use any WCs or drains that are not working. Please dig a hole in your garden and get rid of the refuse there.
The historic cathedral was also destroyed. The provost, the very Reverend R.T. Howard, wearily described the vain attempts to save it.
That grand old parish church, with its tower and spire soaring to the sky and its huge, immense, majestic building, we've all simply loved it. Everybody's loved it. Not only church people, but everybody. It's been part of us. Up on the top roof and the lower roofs and the ground floor, we waited. And then, bomb after bomb, incendiary bombs fell. And we fought them with what we could of the equipment we had, one after the other. It took a long time. And then, finally, a group of three fell on the roof, and well, the fire blazed up, and we had no more sand and no more water and practically no more strength to go on. And the fire got a big hold. The fire station came, but, well, there was not sufficient water to deal with it, and the fire got a complete grip of the roof and burnt from roof to roof, and all the pews blazed up, that great inferno inside. I think we all tried to do our best. The fire service was simply magnificent. By about 1:30, the whole thing was gutted, the pillars in the middle, and the great grand arcade fell down, and the nave of the cathedral was no more. All through that night, the clock serenely struck the hours. Many people far and wide thought that the cathedral was all right. But there it is. That night, the city burnt. And the mother church of the city burnt with her. Can't help feeling that's a sort of emblem of the eternal truth that when men suffer, God suffers with them. And yet the tower and the spire still stand, soaring to the sky, and I feel that's an emblem of the eternal majesty and love of God. It was the spirit of our forefathers that built that grand building. I believe that that spirit is with us still and will help us to rebuild it one day when we've served and suffered a while, a little longer. Build it again to the glory of Jesus Christ.
Just before Christmas, German bombers set the city of London ablaze. Robin Duff reported.
St. Paul's Cathedral was the pivot of the main fire. All around it, the flames were leaping up into the sky. There the cathedral stood, magnificently firm, untouched in the very center of all this destruction. As I walked along the streets, it was almost impossible to believe that these fires could be subdued. I was walking between solid walls of fire. Roofs of shops and office buildings came down with a roaring crash. Panes of glass were cracking everywhere from the heat. And every street was crisscrossed with innumerable lengths of hose. Men were fighting the fires from the top of 100-foot ladders shot up from the street. Others were pushing their way into the burning buildings, taking the jet to the core of the fire. There was a vast number of men there. And apart from occasionally helping to lay out a hose, I saw that there was nothing I could do to help. And so I went instead to some of the public shelters. They were underground shelters mostly, and the buildings on top of them were alight. The people had to be got away from them, and got away quickly, and then taken across to the underground station. Sparks were driving down the street like a heavy snowstorm. Obviously, small children couldn't walk across to the station in this. And so some of us went backwards and forwards, carrying them in our arms. I took off my Macintosh and covered them up completely with it. It must have been rather frightening for them to be carried across by someone they didn't know, and not being able to see anything. But it was the only way to protect them from those sparks. And by the time we got the last one across, Wishton had to do it anyway, because the building above the station was on fire. Luckily, the station escaped, and they were all moved off in trains to get food and drink, and then some much-needed sleep.
Herbert Morrison, Minister of Home Security, appealed for firefighters to beat the incendiary menace across the country.
The fire brigades and auxiliary fire services have done and are doing their usual splendid work. But we must leave them free to fight big fires. The country needs you to see that they have as few fires to fight as possible. Many fire parties are already giving the model and the needed help. We need more still, everywhere.
The offensive against London continued into an unhappy new year. Britain's resolve did not weaken. On May the 11th, 1941, the capital endured its heaviest bombardment, but it was also the last. Other cities went on suffering until the end of May. Then Hitler withdrew the Luftwaffe, his eyes set on Russia. The little blitz of V-1 missiles and V-2 rockets would come in the summer of 1944 as a Führer's last desperate throw of the dice. But the blitz was over. In the course of it, the Germans dropped over 54,000 tons of bombs. 43,000 people were killed, 86,000 injured, and 2 million homes were destroyed, more than half of them in London. If the cessation of the bombing brought any exhilaration, it was quickly dispelled when Britain sustained what seemed to be nothing less than a national catastrophe.
Das Oberkommando der Wehrmacht gibt bekannt. Ein im Atlantik operierender deutscher Flottenverband unter Führung des Flottenchefs Admiral Lütjens stieß im Seegebiet um Island auf schwere englische Seestreitkräfte. Das Schlachtschiff Bismarck hat hierbei einen englischen Schlachtkreuzer, wahrscheinlich Hood, vernichtet.
HMS Hood had been sunk by the Bismarck in the North Atlantic. The battlecruiser was aging. She'd been commissioned in 1920, but she was the largest and fastest warship in the Royal Navy, and as such, she'd been the embodiment of Britain's naval supremacy. Only three of the Hood's complement of 1,421 survived. Among those who died was the BBC correspondent Bernard Stubbs, who'd enlisted shortly after Dunkirk. Within days, the First Sea Lord, A.V. Alexander, announced the Navy's riposte.
Members of ENSAR, they have entertained in the last few months officers and gallant men on the Hood. You will feel as I feel about their last great gallant sacrifice. But the British Navy has in all its decades of history taken good care to avenge things of that kind. And that is why this morning at 11 o'clock the Bismarck was sunk.
The Bismarck, completed in late 1940 and the most powerful warship in the world, had been hunted down. Her end was the end of German surface incursions into the Atlantic. But there were still the German U-boats to contend with, which had now perfected their wolf-pack tactics. There was also the danger of aerial attack. Germany remained intent on destroying enough merchant shipping to force Britain out of the war. During 1941, 875 Allied ships, 3,300,000 tons, were lost in the Atlantic. But continuous close protection by warships was now giving the merchantmen a degree of safety. In the last 3 months of 1941, Allied losses fell dramatically. Robert Dougal was with a convoy that survived an attack by German bombers.
We're now mixed up in, I think I'm right in saying, the first attack on a convoy which has been actually recorded at sea. We've been attacked by bombers. There have been two runs over the convoy as yet. All the ships have been just blazing off like mad. They've got a stick of bombs, but so far no damage has been done. So I've taken up a position by the gun in the stern. It's a 12-pounder, and I'm right amidst the gun crew now. shelves all around me too, and more are being handed out from the magazine below. I expect you can hear the crew. And wait a minute. Here he comes. He's on our port quarter, not much more than 500 feet up, I should say, and just about abreast of us now. There are tracer bullets bursting all around him. He's passing astern, straight over, but you can still follow him through this night cloud. And there go his bombs. There are thick of four of them. They're hanging in the air for a moment. I can see them distinctly, and now they're dropping down over the convoy. But wait a minute. He has missed. Columns of water sprouting up, but he's missed. The ships are still there, and it looks as if we're all right. There's just a faint smell of gunpowder and smoke drifting across the water, but we won't worry about that. He's missed, and everything's okay.
The war suddenly took on another dimension. Hitler invaded Russia. He'd become increasingly suspicious of Soviet moves into the Baltic states and Romania, and was eager for the raw materials and rich resources of the Urals, Siberia, and the Ukraine. In September 1939, he'd signed a 10-year non-aggression pact with Russia. Now, on June the 22nd, 1941, he betrayed it, as he'd betrayed a similar pact with Poland. Hitler anticipated a short war, after which he would deal with the unfinished business he had with Britain. Few, including Hitler and Stalin, thought that Churchill would welcome the Soviet communists as his allies. Churchill said, "If Hitler were to launch an attack on hell itself, I would at least contrive to make a favorable reference to the devil in the House of Commons." He came to the microphone, his voice filled with contempt for the German leader.
At 4 o'clock this morning, Hitler attacked and invaded Russia. This was no surprise to me. In fact, I gave clear and precise warnings to Stalin of what was coming. I gave him warnings, as I have given warnings to others before. Hitler is a monster of wickedness, insatiable in his lust for blood and plunder. So now this bloodthirsty gutter snipe must launch his mechanized armies upon new fields of slaughter, pillage, and devastation.
After the Battle of Britain, RAF Bomber Command stepped up its night operations. By the end of 1941, it had adopted the controversial policy of area bombing of German towns and cities.
Reports from the Air Ministry late this evening give a fuller picture of last night's air raid on Berlin, the heaviest ever carried out on the capital, and one which coincided with the first anniversary of the first mass attack by the Germans on London at night.
Hello, skipper. Hello, navigator. Half a minute to go. Okay, thanks for reminding.
Okay, keep weaving, Ken. There's quite a lot of night stuff coming up as well, falling off a bit low.
Hello, engineer. Skipper here. Yeah? Will you put the revs up, please? Yeah?
Okay, keep weaving.
A lot of thirst lights and fighter flares, skipper.
There, yeah, keep on.
Okay, boys, okay.
Left, left. Right, you can... Bomb door open.
Hello, bombardier. Okay when you are.
Bomb door open.
Bomb door's open, bombardier.
Right. Steady. Steady. Bomb's going in a minute, bomb.
Hey, Jimmy, tracer behind us, boy.
Bomb citizen.
Hurry up, Jimmy, hold it up. Where is he, rear gunner? Can you see him?
Down! Down!
Down!
He's chopped down! He's shot down.
Did you shoot him down?
Yeah,
he's got him, boy. Right in the middle.
Bloody good.
Bloody good. Keep waving. There's some black coming at me.
Okay, don't shout all at once.
All right. Photograph taken.
Okay, photograph taken. Hello, skipper. Will you turn on to 081? Right, 081, navigator. Don't all speak at once now. Keep quiet. It's okay.
Okay, let's go.
Hello, mid-gunner. Did you recognize that fighter you shot on?
No, I didn't recognize it, but it's definitely going down now.
Good, Jimmy. I can see him, boy. Good show. I can see him now.
Yeah, look at him burning. Doesn't he look lovely?
Good show, lads. Now keep your eyes open.
Okay, Ken.
On the other side of the world, Japan had been trying to conquer China since 1937 and sought other expansion. The fall of France provided the opportunity. Having signed a tripartite pact with Germany and Italy, the Japanese took control of the French colony of Indochina. The United States imposed an oil embargo in the hope of curtailing Japan's plans. With no more than 2 years' oil reserves, Japan faced the stark choice between losing face or going to war. On December the 7th, 1941, came the preemptive strike on Pearl Harbor. About 350 aircraft, launched from aircraft carriers, sank or put out of action six of the eight American battleships that were at anchor in the Hawaiian Islands. The harbor installations were relatively undamaged, and the American fleet's three aircraft carriers were at sea and therefore unscathed, important factors in the coming Battle of the Pacific. Most significantly of all, America, which until this attack had remained neutral, was now drawn into the fight against the Axis powers.
Here is the news. Japan's long-threatened aggression in the Far East began tonight with air attacks on United States naval bases in the Pacific. Fresh reports are coming in every minute. The latest facts of the situation are these. Messages from Tokyo say that Japan has announced a formal declaration of war against both the United States and Britain. The Japanese air raids were made on the Hawaiian Islands and the Philippines. Observers' reports say that an American battleship has been hit and that a number of the Japanese bombers have been shot down. A naval action is in progress off Honolulu, and American transport with timber on board has been torpedoed in the Pacific, and another cargo ship is reported in distress. President Roosevelt has told the Army and Navy to act on their secret orders, has called a meeting of ministers, and is preparing a report for Congress. In London, Mr. Wynant has seen Mr. Churchill, and both Houses of Parliament have been summoned for tomorrow afternoon to hear a statement on the situation.
In this nation's capital, the Japanese attack on Hawaii and the Philippine Islands and the torpedo assault on two American cargo ships in the Pacific have come with an electrifying shock. There are crowds right now gathered in front of the White House and the State Department and the Japanese Embassy. They are sober, quiet crowds. There is more excitement among a crowd of 150 newspaper men jammed within the lobby of the White House Executive Office. For a comparatively few feet away, the President is dictating the first draft of a message to Congress. That much is announced at the White House. And this means that a joint session of Congress will be held probably as early as tomorrow, at which the President will announce the Japanese attack upon the United States and ask for a declaration of war.
No matter how long it may take us to overcome this premeditated invasion, the American people in their righteous might will win through to absolute victory. I ask that the Congress declare that since the unprovoked and dastardly attack by Japan on Sunday, December 7th, 1941, a state of war has existed between the United States and the Japanese Empire.
President Roosevelt. At home on the same day, more details of Japan's aggression were given by Wilfred Pickles, the first North countryman ever to read the BBC News.
This is the BBC Home and Forces programme. Here's the news. This is Wilfred Pickles reading it. This morning's news of Japan's aggression is of successful countermeasures against the invasion of Malaya. There have also been reports of enemy attacks on Thailand and Hong Kong. At Shanghai, the Japanese have taken over the international waterfront and sunk the British gunboat Petrel. President Roosevelt has spoken of serious damage and casualties in the earlier Japanese air raids on America's Pacific naval bases, and the Japanese are reported to have lost an aircraft carrier and some of their bombers and submarines.
In Washington, Churchill addressed Congress.
After the outrages they have committed upon us at Pearl Harbor, in the Pacific Islands, in the Philippines, in Malaya and the Dutch East Indies, they must now know that the stakes for which they have decided to play are mortal. When we look at the resources of the United States and the British Empire compared to those of Japan, when we remember those of China, which have so long valiantly withstood invasion and tyranny, and when also we observe the Russian menace which hangs over Japan, it becomes still more difficult to reconcile Japanese action with prudence or even with sanity. What kind of a people do they think we are? Is it possible they do not realize that we shall never cease to persevere against them until they have been taught a lesson which they and the world will never forget?
Malaya, Thailand, the Philippines, Burma, Borneo. Japanese forces flooded across Southeast Asia, seizing American, British, and Dutch territories. In December, the British garrison in Hong Kong fell. In February 1942, the garrison in Singapore surrendered, having lost 64,000 British and Empire troops, 20,000 more than the British had lost at Dunkirk. Giles Playfair described the last eerie days before Singapore's fall.
There was a sort of joyous, anarchical abandon about life in Singapore during those last days. For one thing, possessions didn't count anymore. Money didn't matter either. The most you hoped for was to preserve your life and, if possible, your freedom. And the old saying, drink and be merry, for tomorrow ye die, was fully translated into a gloriously irresponsible reality. I remember that after I'd seen my wife off to Java about a fortnight before the fall of Singapore, I came away feeling naturally rather depressed to find that my car had been requisitioned or stolen. So in desperation, I asked a complete stranger for a lift, who was going the same way as I was. I told him what had happened, and he said quite casually, "Oh, well, would you like this car? I've got two, so I don't really need it." I thanked him very much, and he gave me the keys, and that was that. Well, you see, that's an illustration of the whole atmosphere in Singapore during those last days.
In the Pacific, American forces, assisted by those of Australia and New Zealand, began the difficult task of reconquering the islands captured by the Japanese. Several crucial naval clashes played their part in halting the Japanese offensive. In May 1942, the Americans attacked Japanese warships escorting a force that aimed to capture Port Moresby, New Guinea, in the Coral Sea between Australia and New Caledonia. Losses on both sides were about equal, but the Japanese were turned back. This was the first of the new style naval battles in which the capital ships, the aircraft carriers, never even saw those on the other side. A larger battle of the same kind occurred in June when a powerful Japanese force intending to capture Midway Island, 1,000 miles west of Pearl Harbor, was caught and attacked. The Americans sank 4 Japanese carriers and destroyed many of Japan's aircraft for the loss of one of their own.
Only a few short hours ago that we docked our battered ship at the Philadelphia Navy Yard and were honored by a visit from Admiral King. I'm still trying to get myself adjusted to the unaccustomed feeling of peace and security which comes after such a battle. We licked the Japs in a major slugging match between surface ships, and though it would be almost impossible for me to give a complete description of the battle, these are a few of the impressions which I'll never forget. I remember the tenseness preceding action, waiting for the range to close, the captain in huddle with other officers, and then saying, "Ready, Bill, ready, John, let her go." I remember the sheets of flame which came up and almost blinded us from our guns, filled the sky before our eyes, and then the shells as they started on their way, fireworks more spectacular than any 4th of July. Pinpoints of red winging their way toward the target in a cluster, then to burst on the target in geysers of flame and smoke. The first target left a distinct impression. As the salvo hit the cruiser, she seemed to disintegrate on the spot in a sheet of flame and go down by the bow with her screws still turning. It was only a pall of smoke where she had been before. The other targets went almost the same. In those crowded minutes, we shifted fire rapidly from one target to another with hardly a pause between salvos. I can remember the captain standing there in that indescribable noise and confusion, always the complete master of the situation, coolly shifting fire to engage each target as it appeared. The first touch of realism for myself occurred when a direct hit on the captain's cabin below sent up a sheet of flame before my eyes. Other reports from all over the ship indicated that misses were falling both short of us and over. It was a ghostly feeling to realize those shells would probably soon find their mark. It was a moment of doubt for all of us, most of us anyhow, fearing the magazines would blow up. And then the captain stepped up and looked down and said, "Hell, we're all right." That was the turning point for most of us. Confidence returned again.
In November came the Battle of Guadalcanal in the Solomon Islands. The Japanese fleet attempted to put troops and supplies ashore to reinforce the army that for 6 months had fought a war of attrition with U.S. Marines. Losses at sea were heavy on both sides. Both American admirals involved in the engagement were killed. But victory gave the Americans the initiative in the Pacific. As they advanced from island to island, they swiftly built airfields from which to attack enemy bases nearer Japan. Early in 1941, the Desert War in North Africa appeared to be virtually over. The British Imperial forces were poised to eject the Italians from Libya. Then Hitler sent the Afrika Korps under Rommel. The war swung back and forth, with the British suffering heavy losses and continually forced to withdraw east. Outmaneuvered and heavily defeated at Gazala near Tobruk in June 1942, the 8th Army retreated yet again and dug itself in at El Alamein, 70 miles from Alexandria. It seemed that Egypt, with its vital supply routes, would be overrun. The multiracial 8th Army of Britons, Australians, New Zealanders, South Africans, Indians and others was badly demoralized and had come to believe that Rommel was invincible. A new general arrived in August to take command. His name was Bernard Law Montgomery, and he would hear nothing of Rommel's invincibility or of defeat. Montgomery set about rebuilding morale. Understanding the value of radio broadcasting, he frequently gave interviews, saying that through the BBC, he was the first general in history who was able to speak to all his men at the same time. More troops, aircraft, and armor arrived in large numbers. When Rommel tried a surprise attack to break through at Alam Halfa, he was repulsed. In October, Montgomery was ready for the final confrontation.
"Here we will stand and fight. There will be no further withdrawal. I have ordered that all plans and instructions dealing with further withdrawal are to be burnt. And at once, we will stand and fight here. If we can't stay here alive, then let us stay here dead. I want to impress on everyone that the bad times are over. They are finished. Our mandate from the Prime Minister is to destroy the Axis forces in North Africa. I have seen it, written on half a sheet of notepaper. It can be done, and it will be done, beyond any possibility of doubt. What I have done is to get over to you the atmosphere in which we will now work and fight. You must see to it that this new atmosphere permeates right down through the 8th Army, right down to the most junior private soldier. The great point to remember is that we are going to finish with this chap Rommel once and for all. Now, my forecast of this battle is that there will be three definite stages. First, the break-in to the enemy's positions, then the dogfight, and then the breakout. We will do the break-in on the night of the 23rd of October. The dogfight battle will then begin, and it will involve hard and continuous fighting. I believe that the dogfight battle will become a hard killing match and will last for 10 or 12 days. The enemy will crack. Then will come the breakout. And that will lead to the end of Rommel in Africa."
The battle gave BBC correspondent Godfrey Talbot some of the most historic recordings of the war. On the first night, he captured the sound of 1,000 guns along a 6-mile front, which laid down an opening barrage that shook the desert.
This is not patrol, but recording of the desert.
The sound you can hear now is the noise of British tanks moving into battle. It's the night of Sunday, Monday, November 1st, 2nd. And it's the early hours of the morning, and here on this desert, with the sand clouds whirling up behind each vehicle, British tanks in large numbers are moving into battle. Shells by the thousand are being pumped into the enemy, and now here we are at the side of one of these desert tracks, watching the armed might of the 8th Army go forward to engage the enemy. The moon, just half a moon, is shining down here, the starry night, and overhead there's not only the moon, but the flares which have been dropped, which are shining down on the desert and illuminating this battleground. Tank after tank is going past, just a few yards from the microphone as I speak now. One can't see very clearly. It's rather like being in a fog. It is indeed a fog, but the fog is a fog of sand, because the sand's very soft here, and each tank as it goes past churns up a great cloud.
Twelve days later, as Monty had predicted, his tanks bored a hole through the German defences.
This is the BBC Home and Forces programme. This is Bruce Belfridge. Here's some excellent news which has come during the past hour in the form of a communique from GHQ Cairo. It says, the Axis forces in the Western Desert, after 12 days and nights of ceaseless attacks by our land and air forces, are now in full retreat. It's known that the enemy's losses in killed and wounded have been exceptionally high.
Rommel retreated towards Tunisia. As Christmas approached, the 8th Army continued its pursuit, and Rommel had no option but to continue his withdrawal towards the Anglo-American force that had invaded French Northwest Africa. The men of Monty's army took a momentary respite before the final slogging months of the last African campaign.
That carol came from some of the men of the 8th Army, and it was sung from the borders of Tripolitania. We are here, we've just pulled off the coast road that goes along there towards Sirte and ultimately to Tripoli, and over by our recording truck there have come one or two men of the 8th Army, and they're led by a corporal. I can see him there in his great coat and tin hat playing a clarinet, as you've just heard, and they've just been having a bit of a sing-song, and we've recorded this bit of it. As a matter of fact, they've been singing all kinds of songs with a bit of difficulty in getting them to sing a carol at all, to be quite honest. And I don't want you to get the impression that the 8th Army is just having a nice picnic and is going gaily singing carols up the coast road after Rommel. They're not at all. They're far too busy fighting this war, and a grim enough business it is, and all this sand and dreary desert, and they've very little time for singing at all. We are a good way at the moment behind our forward troops, who certainly won't be going about caroling tonight. And Christmas, although it will be remembered and celebrated in the desert, won't, to be quite honest, be an affair of plum puddings and merry crackers and parties and good feasting for the men of the 8th Army.
Rationing came to Britain from January 1940, gradually embracing commodities from petrol to soap and clothing. Even a hot water bottle could only be obtained on a doctor's prescription. Food rationing affected people most. At first, it applied only to bacon, ham, butter, and sugar, but was then imposed on meat, tea, cheese, preserves, cooking fat, margarine, and other items, including chocolate and sweets. Foods subject to controlled distribution rather than strict rationing included milk, eggs, oranges, and fish. Coffee, custard powder, pepper, and such items as tinned salmon were among items that were not rationed, but were virtually impossible to find. The British people, living on a dull though adequate diet because of rationing, and constantly concerned about their health, tuned to the radio doctor, the unidentified Charles Hill, for his common sense advice. But they also did so because his down-to-earth language was like no other broadcaster's.
But how are you today? How's your tongue? Is it smooth and red, or knobby and beige with an overcoat of a muddy hue? And how's the stomach? Is it firm and steady, or somewhat warm, or a little wobbly and a trifle windy? Or was your Christmas day so Spartan that today you're fighting fit with no twinge of remorse?
In response to the Ministry of Food's Dig for Victory campaign, millions of men turned their lawns and flower beds into vegetable plots. And millions of housewives listened to the BBC's daily 5-minute Kitchen Front programme, which gave tips on cooking with substitute ingredients. The Kitchen Front gave household tips too, including ways of saving fuel.
We've been getting a lot of letters from listeners who advise cooking with steamers and two-tiered saucepans, if you have one. This is, of course, an excellent plan and saves a lot of fuel. A listener from Belvedere, Kent, used an old saucepan lid. Well, they usually last longer than saucepans, so you'll probably have one or two to spare. Turned it upside down and knocked some holes in that from the inside. It balances marvelously on top of another saucepan, and you can put in your vegetables and cover it with the lid belonging to the saucepan underneath.
The voice of Freddie Gricewood. Saving fuel was a major consideration from the end of 1941, when the government found itself desperately short of the coal needed for its requirements. In January 1942, the government created a new Ministry of Fuel, Light and Power, released 7,000 miners from the forces, and allowed any man who was called up to opt for the mines instead of the fighting services. Shop window lighting was banned, and the manufacture of most electric appliances. Personal units of fuel were introduced. Everyone was asked to economize, to share a fire, to bath in no more than 5 inches of water. In 1944, despite its round-the-clock production lines, Britain was using 11 million tons of coal less than before the war. When Hitler attacked the Soviet Union in 1941, his plan was to drive deep wedges into Russia, spearheaded by his tanks, and to eliminate the Red Army in giant encirclements before the onset of winter. Initially, the plan went well. The Germans reached the outskirts of Leningrad by the autumn, and by December were in the suburbs of Moscow. Further south, they reached Rostov, near the mouth of the River Don. 2 million Russian prisoners were taken. Then, the Red Army counterattacked. Hitler forbade retreat. The temperature dropped to minus 40 degrees. Exhausted by their exertions and without winter clothing, the Germans suffered terrible losses, although they managed to hold positions deep inside the USSR. In 1942, Hitler decided to take the Soviet oil fields in the Caucasus region between the Black and Caspian Seas. One German army reached the oil center of Maikop in August. The attack further north, at Stalingrad, failed.
The triumphant conclusion of the Battle of Stalingrad, with the capture of 8 more German generals and 45,000 other prisoners in the past 2 days, has overshadowed the rest of the news from Russia. But our allies have kept up their great advance on the southern front. The programs of the German radio were interrupted this afternoon to broadcast the special communique. It was followed by sustained funeral drum rolls and by slow music, then by the national anthem and a 3-minute silence. A little later, it was announced that Goebbels had ordered all places of entertainment to be closed for 3 days. When this announcement was broadcast, it was followed by more slow music. It has also been announced that the whole public life of Germany for these 3 days will be given over to mourning. All radio programs are being changed.
In November 1942, the German general Paulus had partially captured Stalingrad. The Russians had contested every street and building. On November the 19th, the Russian overall commander, Zhukov, launched a counteroffensive to retake the razed city. Trapped, Paulus fought on for more than 2 months before surrendering to save the remnants of his army from certain annihilation. 240,000 Germans had perished. only 94,000 remained to be taken prisoner. Stalingrad was the turning point on the Eastern Front.
The streets of Stalingrad, if you can give the name to open spaces between ruins, still bear all the marks of battle. There's a usual litter of helmets and weapons, stacks of ammunition, papers fluttering in the snow, pocketbooks from dead Germans, and any number of smashed corpses lying where they fell, or stacked up in great frozen heaps for later burial. Stalingrad can never be repaired. It will have to be rebuilt from the beginning. But even though all its buildings are wrecked, there's life in it still. Along the narrow stretch of cement-colored cliff by the river, which the Russians held through long months of assault, there's a city of dugouts. Dugouts occupied by the soldiers who've not yet left, and by a few women who stayed behind to launder and cook for the men. There's a real holiday atmosphere among these people today. They're the proudest men and women I've ever seen. They know they've done a terrific job and have done it well. Their city's been destroyed, but they've smashed the invader by sheer stubbornness and unconquerable courage. These men and women fought and worked for months with their backs to the river that they'd sworn never to retreat across, facing an enemy who held the only dominating height in Stalingrad and could pound them with shells and mortars unceasingly by day and night. They clung to their narrow foothold, and their feet never slipped.